we start is to remind you to fill out the survey form. I have started looking at the forms and trying accordingly to make changes that will be successful. Also, what I will try to do as soon as I find a time to show you the results of this, I have to wait a little bit for this section because a number of students have not filled out the form. But when I am satisfied with the number of people who have responded, that I will make the results available to you, and then I will tell you what I learned from the comments, all right, and what to do. So that's what I wanted to say, one thing. The other thing that I don't want to miss is that this week, especially starting on Wednesday, we are going to start reviews. All right, so Wednesday for problem solving session, we'll have a review, which I will also record. And I will put my notes up, we'll solve problems, review problems. We'll do the same thing on Sunday, and we'll do the same thing on Monday. On Monday, we're gonna just do a review in as a lecture for Wednesday. Now, following Wednesday, we have the meter, all right? So that's what we're gonna do. You need to keep that in mind. I will send you an email also to remind you. And the other thing is that today we're gonna have an exercise which I have already activated. So I have already assigned this exercise. And okay, I don't know because here my screen changed. Do you see those who are online? Do you see what I share or you don't see it? What do you see? Let me see.
Yes, we see it. We see examples and magnetostatics.
Okay. Magnetostatics. Perfect. Thank you for letting me know because the system pulled it out from what I see. How about you here? What do you, let me see. So that also shows. So probably it's casting this one, isn't it? Which is not very good. Okay. All right, so how are we gonna do this? Wait a second, let me try it again. I will, because the students here cannot see it, I don't know what happened, but I need to initiate okay, this.
Good.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks. What was the problem, rather, the other, the cable?
Yeah, sometimes this can get disconnected.
Okay,
so
all right. Okay, thank you. All right, so today what we are gonna do is to start solving problems using Ampere's law and then Stokes' theorem. All right, so we are gonna start with a simple infinite wire that has a current. Now, I also wanna say that a lot of students indicated that they would very much appreciate having more examples, so that's what I will try to do in my lectures. But the specific examples here in magnetostatics is the most simple ones will be the infinite wire. And then from the infinite wire, we're gonna go to a loop. And then from a loop, we are gonna go to a finite wire. All right, and then we're gonna solve a few combinations. All right, so in the infinite wire, what you see is the following. Here we have what we call a current filament. All right, the current filament is nothing else but a current. It is not necessarily on a conductor or anything. It's just a current that flows along a straight line. All right, sometimes filaments, I mean, this is straight, but filaments can be curved. It's just one, if you like, a filament is nothing else but one line of current that flows. Now, where it ideally would be in a conductor, all right, a very thin conductor, for example, but here we don't have the conductor in place. So it's just a line of current. When electrostatics, we talked about charges. We started with a point charge, all right? And then we went to charge distributions. And then we had, in charge distributions, the volume charge density, the surface charge density, and the line charge density. And in the volume charge density, practically is a charge that you have at one point in space. But also for that charge, we use the name point charge. So a point charge is the full charge at one point, all right? All of your charge is concentrated at one point. The volume charge density is a piece of your charge if this charge is distributed over a volume, all right? So we use the densities when the charge is distributed. And we use the name point charge when the charge is all localized. Same thing with currents. We use the word current filament when all of your current is concentrated along one line and it all flows along this, like this line, which is along the Z direction. And then we have current densities if your current is distributed. All right, so in this particular case, we call it infinite wire or current filament. It's all concentrated in one. And that's why you will see instead of J, because we use J to represent a density. In this particular case, we use I. So for a current filament, I and J, J will be the surface current density. Obviously, it will be identical, like the point charge and the volume charge density, all right? So the current filament, meaning all current on one line, and is gonna be only if all the current is concentrated along one line and flows. And then later on, when we will have current, current distributed over a surface, then we are gonna use the word density, all right? So now all of the current is along one direction and we indicate it with I. And it has a direction and the direction of this current is along the Z, all right? Now, what is the first thing we'll do in these kinds of problems? First of all, you would like to use your right hand and the right hand rule to find what kind of direction the magnetic field that is coming from this current will have. So you put your thumb along the Z direction, your right thumb along the Z direction, and then the rest of the fingers, you'll show the direction of the magnetic field, all right? And when we talk about magnetic field in general, we probably indicate two specific entities. It's either the magnetic field intensity, which is H, or is the magnetic flux density. So, but when we talk about the magnetic field in general, it's either one. However, when I want you to find something specific, I will be very specific. Like here it says in this problem, find the magnetic field intensity, which is H, all right, so in this particular case, that will be H. And the magnetic flux density, which is B. And I would like in this case to find it at a distance D. So from the wire. So the wire is sitting here and it's long and goes to infinity and it has a cylindrical symmetry. All right, from wherever I go around, if I go around like this or it go up and down, I see the same thing. So that has a cylindrical symmetry, which means that the magnetic field from this current will also have a cylindrical symmetry. So I can select any Z, and usually I will go to Z equals zero, but any Z value will be okay because I would see for any Z the same thing. And then I just move myself by D, distance D, away from this filament. which means like here, if I, since there is cylindrical symmetry and I move at a distance d, then on the circle that has that radius, I should expect to see the same thing. All right, so number one, because of cylindrical symmetry. Then what is it that we learn? That two things. Since we said the electric field always runs on a closed, electric current always runs on a closed path, all right? The path closes somewhere. And this, even this line, it closes at infinity, plus infinity and minus infinity. You can think of an infinite line to be like a line straight here and then somewhere closes. The same thing applies to the magnetic field and the magnetic flux density. So in magnetostatics, both the currents as well as the magnetic fields that they excite always are on closed paths. All right, always on closed paths, as opposed to electrostatics, where the electric field starts at one charge and terminates somewhere else. Here, magnetic field lines and magnetic flux lines don't start anywhere, do not terminate anywhere, they run on a closed path. So here, for example, what you see, if you have a wire like this, and I can, let me do this here, just to introduce a page and so I can write. If you have a line like this one here, all right, and that is a current that flows I, then the magnetic field lines, which I will either indicate as H or B, because really there is a very simple relationship between the two. B is the magnetic flux density and is equal to mu H, where mu is the magnetic permeability, just to remind you. And mu will be equal to mu sub r times mu sub naught, where mu sub r is called the relative magnetic constant, and mu sub naught is called the permeability of free space, all right? And every material that has a mu higher than mu naught is called a magnetic material. And there is a whole variation of magnetic materials, all right? And if the material does not have a mu higher than mu naught, then is either air or is a dielectric, all right? Now, if there are materials that have both epsilon and mu that are above epsilon naught and mu naught, they are complex materials that have both dielectric and magnetic properties. And this we're not gonna cover in this class, but of course there are materials that behave both as a dielectric and as a magnetic material, all right? So those exist as well. So having defined this relationship here, we see obviously that since B and H are related through a scalar, so their direction will be identical. And therefore, if one goes on a particular path, the other one is gonna go on a similar path. So both of these E and H go around this according to the right-hand rule. They will go on circles like this around the wire, all right? And they will all be closed at some point and they will extend forever. Now the question is, how does the value, because on each of these circles, the value of the magnetic field is the same, like because of the cylindrical symmetry, like you see here, on every point of the perimetry of this circle, the magnetic field will have the same value. So as you write those concentric circles, each one of them will correspond to a different value of the magnetic field, all right? And they will go forever. So as you go away from the magnetic, from the electric current, so the current, then you will see less and less of a magnetic field, all right? Because the magnetic field expands in two dimensions, obviously. So you're gonna see less of this. And now we are gonna find out from here how it really varies. All right, so the other thing, since on every circle, like this one here, the magnetic field goes like, has the direction, all right? It goes around, is parallel always to the perimeter of the circle at every point. That implies that the magnetic field here will have only the phi component. And you remember in cylindrical coordinates, we have the rho component, the phi component, and the z component, all right? In a cylindrical coordinate system. So this one is gonna have the phi component. It's gonna have only the phi component. And why is that? Because it's gonna be always around, it's gonna circle the wire always like this. So there's not gonna be a z direction to H field. There is not gonna be a rho direction to the H field because it stays on the same circle. All right, so it's only phi direction. So this is what we are recognizing before we try to solve the problem. Then the other thing we recognize, and you will see this written, but I would like to write it also myself for you, is that we have Ampere's law. What does Ampere's law say, as we saw last time? Ampere's law says that the curl of H equals J. That's the general Ampere's law. But our J here is nothing other than I, all right? We talked about that because a filament. So then we write here, this you see exactly what I said. We write here Ampere's law. And then on Ampere's law, we apply the Stokes theorem. So what does the Stokes theorem say? Stokes theorem, and I will, it's a mathematical theorem, obviously. It says the following, that if I have a surface like this, it does not necessarily have to be a circle. For the Stokes theorem, any surface is okay. All right, any surface is okay. So, but let me use this one for now, since we are gonna apply it on a circle. I mean, for now, we are selecting a circle and then the surface of this. So if we select this surface S, and if we have any function, let's take the functions we have selected here. If we have an H and the curl of H, and we have this is equal to I, then Stokes' theorem says that I can take the integral of this open surface S, on this open surface S of curl of H. And since the surface is a vector, of course it's gonna be like that. Okay, the surface is a vector, you remember? And we said that the surface, if it's one circle, is gonna have always the direction which is perpendicular to the surface. Now, if the surface is not a circle, but is a complex surface, then of course it's gonna be a vector, but the vector in this surface is gonna change at every point. But it's still a vector, okay? The surface is a vector if it has a direction, and every surface has a direction. You remember we said that. And then Stokes' theorem says that for this open surface, the integral is equivalent to a closed line integral, all right, of H dot dl. In this particular case, the line is exactly the perimeter of this circle. And dl is nothing else but the direction of this line at every point. All right, and obviously, because of one and two, what are we gonna have? That the line integral of h dot dl is gonna be the surface integral of I ds. All right? If we apply this here, let's observe what is happening, because that's exactly I wrote below exactly this expression. Now, what we said is that the surface S has a direction n, which direction n is along the z direction. And therefore, any fundamental area of the surface, or like any ds, any of these ds's will have the same direction, all right? Because it's a planar surface. So all of the points on this planar surface have the same direction. So any point on this surface is gonna have the same direction. So this ds, the differential surface, is a vector and has the direction of the surface, which is this one here. All right, also we know that our current, which is a vector, because the current has direction, has the direction of the surface, parallel. Of course, the current and the surface have the same directions. So the inner product here between I and ds gives nothing else but I, all right? So practically, this one here gives us I. That's all it gives us, because I is only non-zero at the filament, all right? And if you integrate it over a surface, but it's only non-zero at the center of the surface, of course, gonna be I. There's nothing else to it, all right? So it's gonna be I. And then the front part of it, which where we apply the Stokes theorem, it let's follow it. It gives us, it takes us here. And then what does that say? It says that according to Stokes' theorem, we move from a surface integral, open surface integral, to a closed line integral, which is around the perimeter of the circle. But H has only the phi component, and DL, which is along the direction of the path, has only the phi component, all right? You remember how we define in a cylindrical coordinate system? Let me do it here. If you have a cylindrical coordinate system, I just want to remind you. In a cylindrical coordinate system, we have three coordinates, z, and if this is just a point, rho, and a sub rho goes like that, and a sub phi is always tangential to the circle that goes from that point, all right, and has a center, it's centered at the center of the coordinate system. So in a coordinate system, the three coordinates is a sub rho, which is along the direction of the radius, is called the radial component, a sub phi, which is always perpendicular to the radial component, therefore is tangential to the circle, and then a sub z. So on the basis of that, this one gives us one line integral along the phi direction. And because h sub phi is constant on this circle, it's gonna give us this constant value times what? Times the perimeter of the circle, which is 2 pi, the radius, d. And the radius of this circle is like our distance from the current, remember? We said I wanna be in a distance d from the current. And so I took this distance d from the current, and then the circle that goes from that point where I stand and has as a center, the center of the cylindrical system is that circle there. And of course the radius of that circle is my distance from the current, okay? Which is along the Z axis. So practically this one tells us that the value of this phi component of the magnetic field is nothing else but the current divided by 2 pi times my distance from the current. D. So what does that say? That if I start moving away from the current, all right, if my distance from the current grows, then the value of the magnetic field that I see reduces as the inverse of that, of my distance from the current, all right? So H sub phi here, that's what it says, that H sub phi varies as 1 over D. Where is the distance from the current, okay? Now, one thing that I wanted always to tell you, when we have these formulas, we cannot apply them right on the, say, if you say, I want to find out exactly what happens on the current. These formulas don't apply for that. If, say, for example, your D goes to zero, this expression is going to go to infinity. And of course, we know that there is no way that we're going to have an infinite magnetic field, even if we are sitting on the source. All right? Let's assume that I wear a jacket. And my jacket is like one of these fabrics that have current. You know that they make fabrics, that they have metallic filaments. So you can put an antenna on the fabric, all right? People do that. Let's assume that I have one of these metallic filaments and it's right on me and it runs a current. Do you think the magnetic field on my skin is gonna be infinite? No, otherwise I would be gone, all right? So it's not infinite. What does that mean? Because the magnetic field is not infinite, this formula does not apply. So these formulas that you see that they have one over a distance of some sort, you don't never use them. And then you say, I'm gonna make my distance go to zero. You cannot use this formula. It's not applicable, all right? So you know. Okay, so then we found on the basis of that, that the magnetic field H from this current filament is given by this expression. And then if you use the values that I gave you, I always need to remind you that if I give you values and you need to find, of course, a value, but use the units. The units are important because, for example, here I gave you a current in milliamps and I gave you a distance in centimeters, all right? So practically, you see the distance in centimeters. Then you plug this one here, see? You plug this one here and then you get your magnetic field in microamps per meter, all right? And then if I wanna find from the magnetic field, the magnetic flux density, then I have to multiply the magnetic field by mu. And mu, if it's in free space, is gonna be mu naught. And mu naught in free space, it has a given value, it's in the book, is 4π·10⁻¹ Henry's per meter. That's how we measure it. So now I go in and I plug in and I have amps times Henry's divided by meter square. And this is called Tesla. So amps, let me use a different. Yes, it needs to be divided and has to be 10 to the second. Okay, because it was, let me correct it here. Thank you for telling me that. It needs to be here. Thank you. 10, which in fact is gonna give 5−1. −1, which is gonna give, well, then in that case, I will just leave it the way it is. And I will have 15, what could I say? If it's −1, I can have 15.9 milliamps. So I can have 15.9 milliamps. Okay? Thank you, as a matter of fact. And then from here, if I place that, I will then correct this to be 10⁻⁴. In fact, because I put minus, it had to be plus. So it has to be −1 here. So 10⁻³, what did it say? Okay, here, that will be 15⁻³, just a second, let me correct that. That will be 15.9, 10⁻³, Okay, and that will give 10 to minus 10. 10 to minus 10, which is gonna make it 2 nano. Well, there is a big difference between pico and nano, like 1,000 difference. Okay, so that will be 2 nanotera. Okay, so nano. Okay, thank you. So you need to remember that one amp, here what I was gonna say, 1 amp Henry per meter square is 1 Tesla. Or 1 Weber per meter square. Sometimes you see it as W, but to avoid mixing it up with watts, we put a B in there also, instead of Weber, B, okay? Now, we are going to follow a similar approach, but this one we are gonna use the Biot-Savart law. In the previous one, we used the Ampere's law. This one, we are gonna use a different one. We cannot use the Ampere's law. I mean, it's not gonna help us. So in this particular problem, I wanna find the magnetic field from a circular current loop. So the current now flows around a loop. You see it here, this one. And I give you that the radius of this loop is 2 centimeters. Okay, and then, first of all, I wanna find how the magnetic field lines will go around this loop. So how do I do this? Here, let's assume that I have a small, like a teeny piece of the current, and it's here. All right, let's assume that I have only this, forget about the whole loop for a moment, that I have this. If that, like with the right-hand rule, I will find out that at the center of this tiny current, the magnetic field from there would be around like on these circles, obviously, all right? But since this is finite, it means that if I move from one point, and let's assume that my current was going on an arbitrary path, all right, like this one. Let me indicate this path as an arbitrary path for my current. And this on this arbitrary path, I took now 2 small sections of the current. So in one of them, the circles will be perpendicular to that short section of the current, and it's here. But when I move a little further down along this path, and then I consider a different short section, then the lines will be like that. Now, of course, they will not be identical like this because all of the currents interact. Every single section of the current create a magnetic field that goes in 3 directions. So all of these fields will be superimposed. But the bottom line is that if you have a path that may have any particular shape, you will be pretty safe if you consider that your lines, at least as you go close to that current, your lines will be circulating it, all right? So for example, if I go to this point here of the current, and then if I look for the magnetic field, at that point, the magnetic field will look, it will be a small line like that. Okay, so you are safe to believe that if you go very close to that current, not on it, but very close to it, then your magnetic field there will circulate it. And it's gonna be a tight loop to the current, all right? But as you move away from that section, then of course your lines will form differently because you have interference from the other elements, all right? So you will see then all of these lines to open up. And for a circular element, current element like this, then you're going to have this kind of spherical symmetry. And in, as you approach the center of the loop, then the lines will all come more close to a line along the Z direction, like you see here. All right, along here, when you go very close to the center of the loop, like all of the magnetic field lines will align like that. But as you go away, then they will start bending. So eventually they will come around to circle the wire. They will all close somewhere, all right? None of these lines is an open line. They all, even the one which is along the Z-axis, is gonna close at infinity. So all of the magnetic field lines will close. So that's how you, how I'm thinking, all right, to be able to get an idea about how the magnetic field will look like. Now, you don't necessarily need to know that to be able to solve the problem, but sometimes knowing a little bit, it helps you in the mathematics as well. I mean, you can see I can solve the mathematical problem and I will come to the same conclusion, all right? But I wanted here to show you how you can think about problems that you have not even solved mathematically, about how qualitatively the fields will look like, because that is very helpful. Now, I show what I have here is that I show the loop from like 3D and it looks like an ellipse, but in reality it's a circular loop, all right? And it has a radius of 2A. So now what we wanna do is to find the magnetic field in two places, at point O here and at point B, which is off the surface of the loop by a particular distance. Now, what I will do here, I will find it for point B, because if I find it for point B, then I can find it for any other point, all right? And then I can find for point O, obviously, but I will find it for point B. So I will start with the Biot-Savart law, which is this one. What does the Biot-Savart law tells us? The Biot-Savart law says the following, that if you have a current like this, and let's assume this is a finitesimally small current, all right? Then the field from this at a distance, say R, is gonna be equal to dH, which is 1/4 pi, and then you have di cross r divided by the magnitude of r to the 3rd power. That is Biot-Savart law. Okay? So I wrote it here. I wrote exactly that. In this case, I put a mu. You see the mu that I have in the numerator because I went directly to the magnetic flux density. And what do we remember? That the magnetic flux density is mu times H. All right, so if the Biot-Savart law gives us this, then dB will be mu over 4 pi dI cross R, and then R magnitude of R to the 3rd power. Okay, that's Biot-Savart. So now let's try to move to write this specifically for this problem. If I am this current here, if I am here, this is our source, and I'm looking to find the magnetic flux density at this point B, so practically here, then which one is R? R is the vector AB, do you agree? That's my R, vector AB. So now I'm writing the Biot-Savart law here, but I have, in terms of R, I have vector AB. That's the only difference that I have. And now I need to find vector AB for my problem. So vector AB is nothing else but the combination of two vectors, all right? So if I were to write it separately here, what do I have? I have the pink vector, which is like the radius. Then I have the vertical vector OB, so this is point O. And then this is A. Then I have OB, which is this one. And then I have AB, which is my R distance, which is this one. All right, so practically AB is nothing else but a combination of two vectors, OA and OB. All right, and each one of them has its own direction. And how do I write this? The relationship between AB and the two vectors, OB and OA, is this one here. All right, so the difference between OB and OA gives us AB. How much is OB? OB is along the Z direction, and the magnitude of OB is D. I selected that to be D height above the loop. So OB is nothing else here than DAZ. How much is OA? OA is the radius of the loop, all right? So practically OA has as magnitude A, which is the radius of the loop, and is along the radial direction for the loop. So these two. And you need to remember this has circular symmetry, all right? I go around and I don't see anything different around the current. And since the loop is symmetric, it's a circle around the car, around the z-axis, then you expect at every point on the circle to practically or to have cylindrical symmetry in all of the magnetic fields you're gonna find. So it's gonna be, your field is gonna be independent of the angle phi, independent. So it's gonna be the same whether I am around at point A, or it will be the same if my point A moves around, for example, all right? That's what it says. Now, since I found AB, then I can also found the magnitude of AB to the third power. How much is, this is a rectangular triangle. How much is AB is like D squared plus A squared, because this is D. This is D, and this is A. So AB magnitude is gonna be D squared plus A squared, okay? And therefore, magnitude of AB to the third power is gonna be exactly given by that, okay? So magnitude of AB squared is A squared plus B squared, okay? So AB magnitude is square root of A squared plus B squared. And therefore to the third power is gonna be exactly what I have here. Do you agree with that? Okay. So now I take this, that you see all of this here, and I put them in this equation one. So what do I have? I have mu, I have 4 pi, and then first of all, I need to remember that I have a cross product between vector di, here I have a cross product between vector di and vector ab. But I know that vector di is along the phi direction. And I know that vector ab has both a z and a rho component. So practically when I take this cross product, I remember these formulas from the cylindrical coordinate system. that the cross product between rho and phi is AZ with this order, because cross products, you remember, you cannot change the order, like in a dot product. The cross product of between A sub rho and A sub phi is the opposite of the cross product between A sub phi and A sub rho. And according to what we know about unit vectors in the cylindrical coordinate system, we have these formulas here. Okay, now, if I use those, what I find is very interesting. I find that this magnetic flux density that is due to this infinitesimally small current has two components, a rho component, which is along the radial direction, and a z component along the z direction. All right, and then I give you these two here. But let's now think of the following. Let's look at the di, which is here, and at the other, like a twin current that is on the other side of the diagonal. So if di, if I take di and its twin, which is here, the two of them will be at across the circle, and they will be identical but opposite directions. Which means that the rho, this current will create a D sub B field, which is going to have a Z component and a rho component. But the rho components, because the two currents are opposite, will cancel out. So when I always consider a current and its twin on the other side of the circle, then practically I understand that all of the rho components will cancel out, all right? All of the components which is along the radial direction, when you consider all the infinitesimal di's that make the circle, will cancel out. And so what is left there is only the Z component, all right? Because it's a circle, it's symmetric, and you have cylindrical symmetry. And the Z component, in fact, is gonna be given when you integrate over the whole circle, all right? Because now, after you got rid of the rho component, you can integrate the Z component. And the Z component is identical for all the little sections of current. Does not change, all right? It's the Z direction is always positive and depends on the direction of the current, whether it's positive like this, all right? According to the right-hand rule. So for a current that goes like that, always is positive, all right? So then if I integrate the Z direction of the B, it's gonna give me this expression here. So then I can plug in the numbers I gave, and then the same thing. I can plug all the numbers that I gave. In this case, I think I did it correctly. I put 10 to the second and for centimeters, and then you get it in the form of Tesla. So this is how you will solve the problems, all right? These are two different ways. Now, we are not gonna always solve these problems from the beginning. We are gonna remember the formulas we found, and then we are gonna use those to solve next time more complex problems. So next time I will give you the following problem. I will assume that I have two loops like that. One loop is like this, and the other loop is like this. And I will ask you to find the magnetic field here at the center. Now, I'm not gonna go and calculate them from the beginning. I will find the magnetic field from one, I will find the magnetic field from the other, and I will superimpose. And then if you solve this, then you can solve also this one. No, sorry. This. Okay. Without solving the problem from the beginning, just by getting the expression for one, the expression for the other, but I need to pay attention to the direction of the currents. And then I can superimpose and we can find something interesting. And why this is from all of these two, the most interesting is this one, Why? Because if I have multiple loops like this, what did I find? That the current that flows, or the magnetic field, the current that flows all these multiple loops create a magnetic field which is equal to the number of these loops times what a single loop will create in its center. And that is what we use to design inductors. Okay? So, any questions about this material?
How did you get the, like when you were a little bit higher up, how did you get the EB equation? I think it was a little bit higher than this.
This one? Or higher up?
It was higher up. It was the,
Was it in the previous problem or
higher than that? Oh yeah, it was dB equal to U of H. Yeah.
And dB equals this one from here.
Yes.
Yeah. That I got it from the Biot-Savart law that says practically here that if I have a source located at this point, this is my source. And if I am an observer at this point, and if I want to find the magnetic field where I am because of this source, Biot-Savart law tells us that this magnetic field that is due to this source, which is an infinitesimally short current, that is given by this expression. So we take that. We accept it is correct, obviously, we take it. And if I apply now this expression to our problem, my source is here, and I am the observer here. And therefore, if I am at B, point B, and I look at the source and I wanna find out what kind of a magnetic field is here because of that source, then I use this formula. Because my distance, when I'm sitting at point B, my distance from the source, which is sitting at point A, is the vector AB. Is that clarifying?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, then I need to tell you the following. When I have when I have a circular loop like this, because that's gonna help you in your exercise. If I have a circular loop like this, where do you think my field is gonna be strongest? At the center, off the center, outside of the loop, what do you think? So where is it gonna be? Here, let me show you. Where is it gonna be? Here, here. Where do you think my strongest is gonna be? Right in the corner.
Strongest magnetic field?
Yes, the magnetic field, at what point the magnetic field comes the same from all of the pieces of current? In the middle. If you move away from the middle, you're not gonna have the same effect where all the pieces contribute the same way. Some pieces, especially outside, some pieces will contribute the same way and some other pieces will contribute much less. All right? Especially, let me show you something here, which is, if you write it, let me write here. Let's assume that I have, this is my loop, all right? This is the loop, but I'm showing the loop now. I do a cut here and I'm showing the loop like this. All right, I'm looking at only at the Z direction, and it's like a cross section of the loop. So if this loop is like that, and then the current goes like this, the current goes in the board here. Okay, let me make it a little bigger so I don't mess up. So the current is gonna be, if I look at the cross section of the current, okay, this is gonna be the Z direction. And the loop is gonna look like that, but it's gonna be going, the current is gonna be going into the pads, and then it's gonna come out of the pads. All right, do you agree with this? If I cut the loop, like a cross section of the loop? Okay, so the current here goes in, and the magnetic field from a current that goes in, if I put my hand like that, all right, goes into, so it's gonna be the magnetic field from this, from the one that goes into the loop, is gonna look like that. You see that? How is the magnetic field that comes out of the loop, of the page? The magnetic field of the current that comes out of the page, which is this, the left, is gonna look like this, but it's gonna have this direction, because the two currents have opposite directions right there when they go close. If I were to go each one of them and look what happens from each one of them, let's in fact, to be easier, let me use this one, but use a different, this one. Let me use a different color so we don't mix up which comes from where. So this one, let's assume this is the field from the one that comes out, and it's gonna have this direction. Okay, now, if I am sitting close to the current that comes out of the page, if I'm sitting close to that one, but I'm looking at the other current, how does the magnetic field from the other current is gonna be? The magnetic field from the other current is gonna be like, because I'm very far away, it's gonna be like this. I mean, something like that on a circle. All right, but how is it gonna be? It's going to be going like this. All right, or in fact, let me see what I will do to help a little more with the drawing. I will do this here, first of all, before I get there. It's gonna go like that. And then I will have another one that's gonna go like this. But the field from this wire that comes out of the board at the same place is gonna look more like that. So what happens outside of the loop? Inside the loop, the fields have the same direction. You see here and here? So inside the loop, they have the same direction, so they sum up. Outside of the loop, what happens? Here.
They cancel out?
It's 4 o'clock.
Exactly, they cancel out. Because of how the magnetic fields run around each part of the wire, all right? So outside of the loop, I would like you to do this drawing the way I have it here, do it, and you will be able to figure out that qualitatively, that inside the loop, the magnetic fields align. Outside of the loop, the magnetic fields go in the opposite direction, they cancel out. Do you see why this is happening here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Add up in between the
yard, exactly. Yes, so
that's why the field is strongest in the center.
Yes, in between, this is the loop, the yellow one, in between the yard. So it's just about how the field lines go. Try to play a little bit. You don't need to go into math with this one to see how the magnetic field lines from each piece. This, and I took the two, and I just took here, the two currents. One here that goes like a filament, a small, and its twin, as we called it, Yeah, just so we know what we are talking about. This one here. All right. I just took this. So that is going to apply everywhere. Inside the loop, the fields sum up. Outside of the loop, the fields cancel out. So outside of the loop, it gets much, much weaker. All right? So look at this so you can feel comfortable with that idea, because it's fundamental to magnetostatics. All right? We are going to talk more when we do more problems on Wednesday. But this is the idea for solving, it's qualitatively the question, solving the exercise problem. Okay? Any other questions? Yes. Yeah, that is true, it would happen, but there is also the thing that we do in a coaxial cable, we have a metal, a conductor, all right? And the field and the currents go on the surface. But what do we do with the external surface of the outside conductor? We ground it. So we force by this all of the currents to be inside the coaxial. And then they sum up, yes. And they give very strong value, yes. Okay? Just think about this and then draw those lines yourselves so you get the idea, feel more comfortable of why this is happening. All right, so we have office hours today, and then I will see you also on Wednesday.
I have a question real quick. So why is it that if you weren't like, it seems that if you were like infinitely close to one of those wires, then the magnetic field due to the wire you're close to would be like,
it's gonna be from one is gonna be much stronger than the other. Yes, but you never go that close. Do you remember what we said?
I remember that from earlier, but like, why would it not be greatest if you were like, let's say like a tenth of a millimeter or something, like really close, but not right.
I'll tell you why. Because if I am at this point, let me call this point B. Call this point P. And then look at this point, which is P prime. All right? P, what is the difference between P and P prime? That in P prime, the fields will sum up. And then at P, the fields will cancel out. Not totally, but that is gonna force, if you have, say, a loop like this. All right? And then I look at the magnetic field, it's gonna force the magnetic field to go down quickly here. It's not gonna make it zero, but it's gonna go down quickly because of the cancellations.
Okay, so I see why it's smaller outside of like the current circle, but why would it be greatest in like the very center as opposed to like if it was just inside?
Because from this point on, fields sum up. And from this point out, fields subtract. That's why you see that kind of derivative, which is like the change is faster here. That's an inflection point, see? These two are inflection points. So from this point P and this point P prime, from P to the left, the field subtract, from P prime to the left, to the right, field subtract, but inside here, the field sum up. And that's why you see that kind of change.
Okay, I'm understanding that part. I'm confused on why it's like why it's greatest at the center between
the center. They all contribute. They all contribute. All of the points on the loop will contribute the same value. And that's why the biggest, the largest values at the center.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. It will protect it from outside interference, but primarily it's gonna stop the outside, the what we call the spillover to the outside. It stops from leaking out. And if it does not leak out, not only is not gonna send anything out, it's not gonna see the outside. If we shield it, nothing is gonna go in either.
Make sure the signal is stronger because it doesn't waste energy.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Yeah. Sure. Oh, yes, sorry. I had a lot of questions today. This